Hey,
Hey, how you doing?
good. How are you?
Doing well. Happy Friday.
Happy Friday. It's not Whiteboard Wednesday, which is a really cool thing you do.
Thanks, appreciate it. Yeah, you know what? What's ironic is I think the naming of Whiteboard Wednesday just kind of fits well. Normally, I don't do it on Wednesday, but it ends up coming out on Wednesday. And actually, fun fact, I got the idea for Whiteboard Wednesday from this guy I used to follow who did a Whiteboard Friday session. He did it on he was the founder of Moz, this like analytics company, and he would do like marketing talk on a whiteboard every Friday. And I learned so much from him, and I love the concept. I'm like, oh, this guy's like a wizard, and I'm learning from him every Friday. And then I'm like, I guess I need to do this for swimming. So then I got the idea from him actually.
What a great idea. You know, it's funny because we're kind of the perfect storm, I think, for me to interview you because I've been a lot of places that you are. And I gotta admit, I was there with a ratty old suitcase, and you're there with the first class everything. But you know, I started a workbook. I wrote software first. I mean, not first, right after high tech. I would look at high tech and go, wow, this isn't really helping people go faster. And it's not motivating, you know. And I talked to high tech and tried to get them to do what I wanted them to do. And they said, you know, these are great ideas, but we own the market. Still, I'm like, well, okay. And so we did that. You know, I interview people, you interview people. It's so funny how similar we are. But here's the biggest compliment I can pay you. I don't know, it might be meaningless to you, but I'm a really good stroke coach. I mean, I have a biomechanics degree. I've coached for 50 years. I can literally hear when someone has a great stroke. I watched Claire Weinstein warm up 2 weeks ago, and I said to her coach, and at the time, it was the only coach I knew that she had. And I said, that girl, she's warming up with Olympians at the La Mirada Armada meet, and she just looks completely different than them. And I went, that girl. And Mark Schubert comes over, and he was there, and he goes, and I had interviewed him a few weeks earlier, and I know him, he's in our area, you know. So he goes, she went out yesterday in 28 and came back in 28. I have never seen that in a 14-year-old girl. And but I already felt it, you know. But then when I listen to you, I hear so many things that are wrong from other people, or they're missing the point. And when you broke down on Whiteboard Wednesday, when you broke down freestyle, I went, this guy's the real thing. So
Thanks.
I just wanted to compliment you on that.
I
My
appreciate it.
day
Thanks.
is, I can only imagine your day, but I just want to tell you a little bit about me. Is my day, this is typical, right? I have a college workout to do. I got somebody coming in. You're a little bit late. So I want to continue this, I hope. And I hope everything went well this morning for you, but I've only got till 10:30 our time. But so I got that. I've got a one-on-one lesson then. I've got college after that. Okay. I do that 3 days a week, and I do underwater filming, and I work with them at CBU. And then my kids are both in college, and they're 13 and 16. So we drive like crazy. My wife should chime in from the background and say, well, I do some of that too. I woke up early to get 50 swimmunicators that, you know, where you can talk to your swimmer while they swim out to Tennessee, and Nashville. And I had to make the brackets for them. They actually had to be kind of redesigned for them. This one person does. Oh, and I have $40,000 worth of strength equipment that's specific to swimming. I invented the rotating swim bench. So you would think I wouldn't be impressed by you, right?
I
I'm
appreciate it.
so impressed by you because when I hear you, when I see you do everything, it's always, first of all, it's first class. Second, you got a billion followers, which I definitely want to talk about how you got there and what your plans are for the future. But I just wanted to tell you, I know I get you, you know, and I think a lot of people look at you and just go, yeah, he's kind of cute. He's a stroke coach. You know, he does these things and he got this logbook. I just think you're amazing. And so now it's your turn. How did you get this way? How did you get into swimming? What's your educational background? I don't think people usually ask this of you. So it's cool to be able to do this.
Oh, I appreciate it. Well, thanks for the hype up. And it means a lot because you have great perspective. It's not like, you know, someone watching the video and they're like, oh, this guy's cool. He knows what he's talking about. Like, you actually have good perspective. So, you know, much above what a normal person has. So that's great to hear. Yeah, so I guess my background, so it's ironic because my parents, they don't swim. Like, they don't know how to swim. So I grew up they moved to the United States. And then when they moved to the area that I grew up in, it's like a waterfront community. So everyone learns how to swim. So they put me in the natural thing of like, okay, we're gonna put them in swim lessons, my older brother and I. And so I did the summer league swim team. So very traditional from that regard, that I did summer swimming. I did high school swimming. I didn't do club year-round swimming until I was a senior in high school. So that's a little bit unique, given like how involved I am now, that I didn't do year-round swimming, but I still really liked it. And I wasn't that good, but I was really small too. So I remember my dad would film me in all the different, in all the races I did in the summer. And I would watch over and over. And this was like with a camcorder. So I'm old enough where the iPhone was not available.
No, me too.
Yeah. It was like with the tape, like with the tape camcorder. So yep. I would go back, I would have like the tape for each me. I would stick it in the camera and I would watch my races. And also my brother is 5 years older than me. So at the time, like he was in the older age groups. And so like the fast swimmers were in his heats. So my brother wasn't winning anything, but I would watch like, why are these people so much faster than say like my brother or faster than me or whatever? And so I was doing like stroke analysis when I was like 10 years old. So I would watch like literally for hour, I would do more stroke analysis when I was 10 than I do right now. So I would watch. Now here's the thing. I wasn't watching like world-class swimmers. I was watching community, like people who were good inside of the community,
which right. isn't
that much. But it got me thinking from like a technical perspective, like really, really early. And then I actually had, you know, like, I think having being surrounded by great coaches. So one of the coaches that I had in the summer league, he was like a collegiate swimmer and he thought about things from a very technical perspective. And we would do the craziest drills and dry land and stuff. No one does this in summer league. And this was especially like 20 years ago, like about, yeah, literally 20 years ago. No one did the stuff that like this would be still weird today, what we were doing then. And now he actually, this guy ended up becoming a software engineer. He was leading corporate security at Facebook. So like this guy is thinking outside the box too, right? So that's where this came from that coach. So it got me thinking like, okay, I'm watching videos analysis when I'm 10. By the time I'm 12, I'm getting really great coaching. Like I would consider, now that I look back, like world-class coaching when I was 12. It didn't really show in my training because I was only doing it for like 8 weeks out of the year. So like, of course I wasn't like a pro because I was only doing it for a short period of time with this superstar coach. So right. that was like my upbringing. And that got me to a point where by the time I got to college, I was like a state level swimmer. So I qualified for like the state championships, but I was not like winning state titles.
What state is this?
Michigan.
Michigan. Okay.
Yeah, so we have some pretty decent people. It's not California, but we have some decent people here. Oh, so yeah. yeah, so I ended up going to university and I wanted to keep swimming, but I wasn't like, I wasn't recruited. I didn't know anything about recruiting actually. And I wasn't good enough to be recruited anyway. So I ended up walking on to the university swim team.
University of Michigan?
No, Wayne State University. I definitely wasn't good enough to swim at University of Michigan. So okay. Wayne State University, Division okay. 2. We were actually like, one of the best in Division 2. So like, okay. even though it was D2, it was still pretty good.
What year is this?
2009.
Okay.
So 2009. So I try out for the swim team, but at the same time, so I tried out and I made the team and I swam on the swim team, but I started coaching USA Club at the same time. So my schedule was college workout at 6 a.m. and then I would have class, afternoon workout, and then I would coach for 4 hours USA Club after that. So I was getting a lot in? Of-
What were you majoring in?
Business.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. So my course load luckily was not that heavy because I had a lot of college credits from high school. I had 22 AP credits, almost a full year taken care of. So I never had a full workload in college.
That's great.
But I loaded it with coaching. So I would coach, like I actually don't know any college swimmers that coach 4 hours a day. I actually still have not met a single college swimmer of any level, Division 1, 2, or 3. That's like a full-time coach, basically. So yeah. I would coach. And then, so I did that in the summers and whatever. So I became like really a nerd with swimming because I was doing it myself 4 hours a day as an athlete. And then I was coaching 4 hours a day. And the team that I was coaching was big enough that we had a lot of different coaches. We had like 200 kids and we had like 8 different coaches. So I started to hear how all these other coaches, and we had a rotational program. So I would coach every single group. So like the 7-year-olds and the 17-year-olds. So because of that, I had like, by the time I was like 18, I had coached alongside like 7 or 8 other coaches, and I had been doing analysis for like 8 years. Like most 18-year-olds don't have that. So no. I kind of knew that, but I didn't outwardly be like, I really know what I'm talking about. But I got a lot more validation over the course of college because in the summers I would train myself and I would write my own workouts, and I realized how efficient I was at writing my own workouts compared to what we were doing in college. And I understood like why the coach would write the workouts a certain way for certain athletes. I wasn't being prioritized because I'm not the fast person, but I could understand. I could start to see that perspective. And then to kind of fast forward, because I'm rambling on now. So to fast forward, like starting my swim pro, basically I was involved in swimming, not only as a swimmer and as a coach, I also started doing video analysis for other swimmers. So I bought a GoPro and I started doing this in like 2011 or 2012. I was a meet official. I was a meet announcer, and I almost worked at another swimming company. And I worked at a company called, have you heard of a swim spray?
No, actually, no.
So it doesn't exist anymore, but back in the day, it was started by a Princeton swimmer, and it's like a spray product that eliminates chlorine from your hair and skin. So okay. I worked for them for 2 summers. So I had like business side, startup side, like I had a really good perspective. And so now college is done. So I'm done with that. And I got like a big person job. So my first job out of college was the Challenge Detroit Fellowship Program. So it's a 1-year fellowship. And basically there's 30 people around the country. They come to Detroit and you work with a company, you work with nonprofits. So it's kind of like a rotational program. So we worked with like 8 or 9 nonprofits over a 12-month period. I was living downtown Detroit. And so this was like my first big boy, like real world, like 9-to-5-ish type of thing.
Right.
And my company that I was working with was a tech startup. And I wanted to be in that startup environment. I actually got an offer from the Detroit Lions to work with them through this program in the marketing department. And I turned down and when I tell people I turned down the Detroit Lions, they're like, that would have been so cool. I'm like, dude, I don't know anything about football. And I wanted to work for a startup. So that's why I picked that over the Detroit Lions.
Yeah.
So I'm working at this technology company. 4 months into this fellowship, the company goes under. They run out of money. They can't raise more financing. So I actually learned a lot in just a 4-month period of time. I learned enough to know what was going on. And then I joined another startup. And so I joined this other startup and I was there for about a year. And it was at that startup that I started my swim pro. But I never stopped coaching swimming. So even through these other things, I was coaching master swimming in the morning, and I was still training myself like as an athlete personally. So I still went to like masters nationals myself, and I was coaching swimmers in master swimming. So I started coaching adults around 2012. I graduated 2013. So for about 2 years there, I was coaching adults, and that's where the idea for my swim pro came about, because I was coaching people who didn't have much of a swimming background. So it became obvious to me, like, wow, like people don't know anything. Like I thought some of the you get spoiled. Like when you're in the competitive bubble, you don't realize how like most of the world doesn't know what 5/100s on the 130 means. Like that's a completely foreign language. But you take that for granted when you're in the bubble of swimming. Like, oh, of course, 5/100s on the you can list off what fast people could do those intervals on and how much rest they would get and how many strokes they would take. No one knows any of this. So I realized this only when I was coaching adults, and I had swimmers like that I either trained with in college or like they knew that I was coaching, and they would ask me for workouts. They would ask me for training advice, for help. And so that really sealed the deal in my mind of like, wow, there's so many people out there who have no idea what they're doing. They're looking for workouts. They want a personal coach, but they can't come to a master's program that I'm coaching because it's at 5:30 a.m. where I live, and they live somewhere else, and they can't afford it. And so it became really clear, like, why doesn't it exist where you can just go to an app, go to a website, and have a personalized plan? You can go to a website and find workouts. That's not hard.
No.
There's plenty of coaches that publish workouts. That's not what I want to do. That's not what we're building at my swim pro. What we're doing is the software is dynamically creating plans based on your goal, based on your speed, because that's what a coach would do.
Yeah.
A good coach would come to you and they'd be like, look, man, I'm trying to go 51 in the 100 fly. This is what I go now. I can swim 5 times a week. Tell me what to do. That's what a good coach would do. But if you're not on a team, if you're not on Palo Alto Stanford Aquatics, if you're not on the Fort Lauderdale Masters team.
Why don't you bring him up? Yeah.
You're not going to get any of this stuff. Like, you're just not. Yeah. So, but people want it. And there's millions of people. That's what they want. So anyway, that was the inception for my swim pro. And because I was working at tech startups, it was like, to me, it was very obvious. Like, oh, this is, I see a problem. I want to create a solution for it. This is how you build a tech company. Mm. And this is what we're going to do. So this was around 2014 was that idea. And then 2015 is when we actually launched my swim pro. So that was kind of all the different things that contributed to it. And I mean, in retrospect, like a lot has happened, but at the same time, I'm still working towards the same thing. So really it's the problem hasn't changed that I'm trying to solve.
So how many people are taking advantage of your service now?
You mean like using the app?
Yeah.
So the app, we have 7,500 paying customers right now. And we have about 30,000 people are using the app on a regular basis. So we have like a free version of the app that you can log swims from like an Apple Watch or Garmin. You can track all your swims. Mm-hmm. And then the paid version is like the workout plan stuff. So that's the people that are using the app, which I believe is still very, very small. Like this is like nothing. So I believe there's so much potential opportunity. Like people hear like 7,000, like my team is like 100 people and you're coaching 7,000 people. Like sort of, not really. There's a much bigger pool for, you know, pun intended, of people that we can help internationally, especially because people sometimes forget, they think, you know, especially in America, like the US is 4% of the world's population. Most people who swim don't live in the US. And sometimes we forget about that.
No, yeah, I know. It's real easy when you're centric to be an American. You know, here's something to put it in perspective for you that might make you feel a little better though, at least right now. And I realize what you're saying. I mean, there's 400,000 registered USA swimmers and you're looking at 7 and, oh yeah, I don't really have the impact. But here's the thing. I just got done, you know, I'm interviewing like a lot of people. I don't know if you've seen Competitive Swimmer Magazine, but we're kind of going kind of ape. At first, World Swimming Coach Association sort of hired me, no money, but anyway, hired me to talk to as many Tokyo Olympic coaches as I could. And so we got some of those out and now we're going kind of crazy. And so I can do kind of whatever I want to do. And I feel like you at 10 years old, I feel like I was kind of the same way, you know, I was pretty young and I feel like I want to learn so much more. And that's a good thing in an interviewer. And it's a good thing in somebody that wants to write. I'm working with Ron Aiken to write sophisticated software that he has. And I'm not saying that yours isn't. In fact, it would be a great collaboration with us, I think, because I see the other side of it. But anyway, I talked to Aska's CEO yesterday, Jennifer Lamont. And I said, how many members do you have? And they have about 8,000 members. I'm like, well,
wow.
and here's the thing. It's funny how this is connected. I said, you know, we're working on this software. And she's like, and she had a really good point. Not everybody needs to coach the same way. And I'm like, yes, but I believe that at least from the ASCA point of view, from the USA Swimming point of view and others, I just had John Rudd with World Swimming Coach Association. So back to your point about, hey, there's a lot more to the world than America, even though we do dominate the sport relative, not relative to our population, but relative to the population of the elite swimmers. I don't think we do anywhere near the job we should with our age group swimmers. And I can tell you a funny story about that. I was speaking at the Olympic Training Center one time and their sports scientist came up and said, Steve, you have to dummy down what you're saying. I'm like, I don't even have that much. So at the time, I didn't have that much science background. They said, no, you don't understand. We've had coaches here for over a week, listening to all our sports scientists, learning how to coach stroke. The flume was there, right? So they could see underwater and they could analyze. They said a coach raised his hand on the last day and he said, they were talking about physiology. He said, we have solved the problem with lactate. And so Dr. John Trope at the time. And he looked down at him. He goes, he was on the stage or whatever doing the thing. And he goes, well, how do you solve the problem of lactate? Cause you know, like we don't have lactate problems anymore. The guy goes, we don't let them drink milk. He said, that's what you're up against. John Leonard one time when I think we were up to close to 3,000 movies on stroke. I broke down every single thing. And this was back in the, you know, back before there was computers, almost literally. There's certainly before Google, okay? Before any of that, we broke it down, put it on CDs, and I broke out every little thing. And John Leonard said, this is wonderful. And of course, not everybody's going to agree, like they probably don't with you, with exactly what you say about stroke. they said, but this, he said, this is a wonderful contribution. And I still have it. He put it on my phone machine and I kept it. I was like, whoa, John Leonard said that from ASCA. But then he said, the funny thing is that you keep telling people to film their own swimmers. But John Leonard said this right out of his mouth. He said, 90% of the coaches, when they see the underwater video, don't know what they're seeing and don't know what to do about it. And this is the contribution that I've been trying to make. This is absolutely the contribution that if coaches pay attention to you, I know you're going after swimmers, but I think if coaches pay attention to you, combine that with Ron Aiken, who's really doing the job. Let's face it. We're coaches. John Aiken is, I mean, Ron is just a whole other world, as Schubert is, and et cetera. There's these people, they know we're interviewing McGlishko. We got Sweetenham on Saturday. These people are, they see the world of swimming in a level that I think you do. I think I do. But I think there's another thing about the whole concept. The whole idea that you said is I don't really coach all those people, but what if I could give them tools where they could coach themselves in a way that would be so much better? And does that make them more coachable? And my answer on in the field, I bet yours is too, and I'll just leave it to you to talk about this, is are these swimmers more coachable after they've gotten educated by the kind of software and the kind of, you know, whiteboard Wednesdays and that kind of thing that you're doing? Do you find them, do you think it's a really great service for coaches?
Yeah, and actually I'll use the whiteboard Wednesday as an example. So whiteboard Wednesdays have been seen by millions of people. Actually, they get seen by millions of people every month. So if you think about, well, who are these people? Like, who are the, if I say a million people, like people don't understand how to like quantify that. So you got to take like the big house in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and like these big stadiums, they fit 100,000 people. So you got to fill that with 10 times. And that's how many people are listening to me talk.
That's insane. That's awesome.
So who are these people? They're not just random people off the street. These are people who you wouldn't pay attention unless you're one of two categories, three categories. You're either the swimmer yourself and you're actively going to the pool twice a week, three times a week, seven times a week, 10 times a week. So because you're going every single week, you have an interest in listening to someone talk about the thing that you do. It partially, like, you're kind of selfish. Like, of course I'm going to listen to this. It's kind of like when people watch like CNBC Money. Like, if you have a lot of money invested in the stock market, you want to listen to financial news because you have a self-interest in like benefiting from, whether you actually like what they're saying or not, you have an interest because you're doing the activity at a very frequent rate. So the biggest group is people who actually swim, right? And these could be your age group swimmers, they're master swimmers, they're all ages. We have a very, very wide, and anywhere in the world, because, you know, again, people swim all over the world. So that's one category. Another category are the coaches. So these are the people who, they have a similar vested interest in that they're doing this thing every single day, but they're kind of stacking up their own knowledge set against the way that I'm explaining a concept that they probably already know. So a lot of times I actually get messages of coaches who watch the Whiteboard Wednesday or they watch the content, and it's revalidating for what they already know. And it's like good to hear that someone else is explaining it the way that I'm explaining it. And sometimes coaches will actually share the video with their swimmers. So they'll send the video and to their like WhatsApp group, or they'll actually play, I've seen this, they play the Whiteboard Wednesday at the pool deck to basically give the swimmers another voice that revalidates what they're saying. Absolutely. So when they're saying, hey, streamline is really important, it's going to make you swim faster. If you don't believe me, here's this guy on the internet that, look, a million people watch this. So clearly he knows what he's talking about. And he said the same thing that I said. So it's this revalidation for both the coach and their swimmers that they're coaching. So that's another group of people that are watching and benefiting from the content. And then the third group of people are the people who have not taken action yet. So they're not coaches and they're not swimmers right now, but they're thinking about either, like, this is the adult masters group or triathletes. They're thinking about getting into swimming. And it's kind of like when you watch, like, on the internet, you watch like workout videos, it's like they're doing push-ups and I'm eating popcorn watching them. That's that group. So they're like, they could be swimming, they could be coaching, but maybe they're on break right now, or they're a seasonal athlete. This would be the person like me in the summer when I was a kid growing up. If I existed for the younger version of me, even though I wasn't swimming, I would be religiously watching like me talking about these Whiteboard Wednesdays, even though I know I'm not going to touch a pool for the next 3 months, but I would be engaging and trying to absorb because I don't have access to, and that's what happening during the pandemic. Like, pools are shut down. people are still benefiting because they just want to, they want to absorb it, even if they're not swimming right now. So anyway, that's the three groups of people that are absorbing the content and also the mobile app. Now, to answer your question more directly of like how beneficial I think it is, I think the more mediums people have to absorb information and content, they're in a better position to be able to benefit from it and then improve at a faster rate. So I think if you go, like, if thinking back to my own personal example, when I was 10 years old, I literally went 9 months without swimming. And so even though I was thinking about it, and I remember in the spring, I would rewatch videos from the last summer. That's how I would watch videos. I would rewatch old stuff. But now with what I'm doing and what you're doing, what other people are doing, you can watch fresh content every hour of every day. Yeah. There's always something new. And so because of that, people can absorb information more quickly and then they can act on it more quickly because now they know, oh, that's the thing. I already learned about that. Now I want to learn about the next thing. And instead of waiting 9 months, I can just do it an hour later, or like I can do it next week, or the Whiteboard Wednesday, I can just wait until the next week and learn the next concept that he's going to talk about. So sure. I think in terms of like the market of swimming, like it should continue to advance because now if someone breaks a national age group record, or I expect to see a video of it. If someone breaks a world record, I expect to hear about it within hours. And I expect to see a video of that swim immediately. And now the next level is people expect me to do an analysis of that world record within like a week. Like people, every time someone breaks a world record, I get a message saying, can you do an analysis on this guy? Or can you do an analysis on this person's, like, how do you, like, I want to hear you break it down. So that way I'm more aware of how to interpret what I'm seeing. Back to what you're saying about, okay, I'm looking at a video, what am I looking at?
Right.
If you see multiple people break down multiple videos, it just gives you another perspective how to analyze what you're looking at. And right. So I think the sport is in a much more interesting spot now in the last like 10 to 20 years because it's so easy to access this information. Like 20 years ago, like what I was doing, it's not easy. I was watching video from a summer league of myself and my older brother that happened like 9 months ago. And we were going like 40 seconds into 50 breaths. That's what I was learning off of.
You know, it's funny. I talked to, I can't remember his name. He got in trouble and he's not a coach anymore, but that guy, if you remember, he came up with something that you put over your head and you can actually watch swimmers. You probably saw this because you're a freak like I am about this stuff, but it was like a virtual reality thing. And you watched ideal swimmers and they were actually going to use some of my video and my analysis to do it. And then they just fell apart. But anyway, it was a cool idea. But one of the interesting things they told me not to any point you just made, but it just brought it in my head is they said, like I said, you know, I'm filming all the time and I film people. I show them their video and I show them what they're doing wrong. And then I, you know, tell them how to do it right. And I literally, when I'm doing one-on-one, because I do coach up thing where they link me to one-on-one with swimmers that want to be really good. And I charge too much so that I don't have too many people. But anyway, I get in the water with them. I take a camera, go underwater with my goggles. I bring it up. We look at it. I grab their arm. I rotate their shoulder so that they're exactly in the right position to be able to pull, because a lot of times they'll reach, it looks the same, but if you just rotate it, I have to actually physically do that. Yeah. But what they said was interesting. They said, don't show them doing it wrong very much. Mm. Just do it for a second and then show them ideally, and this is something I got from a really good sports psychologist, because I do that too, is show them themselves doing it perfectly. And then what I suggest to coaches is show yourself, like you're sitting there with your hood on and before your races, you could be doing a lot of things and you could be watching, especially when you're yes. at a meet where there's a lot of people and like age group meet, and you're watching the slower swimmers swim first. You don't want to watch them, especially breaststroke. I mean, I bet you'd agree, especially breaststroke, because you get a little off in rhythm and like it's over, right? You know, ask Lily King in the Olympics. So, you know, and but anyway, that was very interesting that unlike what you had to do at the time, what I had to do at the time, we can watch kind of idealized swimmers. Yeah. But there's another thing. I wonder if you agree with me on this. So now we're going to talk shop a little bit at the next level. When you do your videos in the ideal videos, I know you're doing breakdown of analysis of the best swimmers, but let's face it, Rocco Meering's breaststroker looks a lot different than Lydia Jacoby. She's got a different thing we do. So when I broke it down with Rocco, and I did stroke by stroke, we actually found some things that Schoenmacher can do better. And he goes, I want to hire you. I bet you get this sometimes too. I'm going to bring you to South Africa. I'm like, no, but let's face it. She shouldn't be doing what I just said, unless she should be doing what I just said. And at that level, we got to figure out, is that really going to work for her? So this is where the art of, and I don't mean the elite coach, but the coach that wants to be as good as you did and do, and the coach that wants to be as good as I am and want to continue to grow to. When you show your idealized videos, are you sometimes saying, well, this is how your stroke should be if you're 6 foot tall at 14. This is maybe how your stroke should be if you're 5 foot four, you know, at 18 or whatever, or college, whatever. Do you differentiate between those two things?
A little bit. What I actually do is more controversial. I always criticize everyone's stroke. So like I'll watch Michael Phelps and be like, no, he's not, he could have done this better. Even for like him, he could have been better here, here, and here. We have a video, it was like viral on TikTok. It was me analyzing Ryan Lochte's flip turn. And I was saying how like, this is bad. He's probably doing it because this was a filming session. He's probably a lot, I've seen him do it better here. The way his hands are, that's not good. You shouldn't do that. And then the comments are like, who is this guy criticizing Ryan Lochte? And like, I don't care what you say. Like at the end of the day, it's like 1 + 1 = 2. He's showing me 1 + 1 = 2.3. He's not 100% wrong, but he's wrong. He could be doing it better here. Like basic physics, right? The way I do it is I just analyze the stroke as it is. So like I did Adam Peaty's 5,700 breaststroke when he went 50, he's done 57 a bunch of times. But I have a video on YouTube, is me talking about his 57 and I break it down. I show his splits, his pace, whatever. I talk a little bit about his technique. And I say like, this is what he's doing. This is why he's going as fast as he's going. I don't really say, if you want to go as fast as him, do what he did. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm very clear with like, this is how he, I'm doing an analysis. I'm not really coaching how to do what he's doing. Now, there are things that we can learn from Adam Peaty because he's going so fast. And normally that's actually very generic. It's like, you got to have a strong kick. You got to have good technique. Like it's very basic. Like, well, yeah, you can say that for anyone. So what I do from an analysis perspective, I more so break down, this is what they're doing. And you should learn from it from the perspective of like, well, why are they going so fast? And why is it working for them? Not really, this is what you should be doing. Because I think a good example of this is like breaststroke. I rarely ever say Adam Peaty is the best breaststroke technique. I never say that. I always say Kazuke Kitajima from Japan. I always reference him. And unfortunately, there isn't that much amazing footage of him. It's kind of like, this was, you know, like over 10 years ago. But I even like the other day, someone was like, yeah, my breaststroke technique, whatever. And they mentioned, I think it was Petey. And I'm like, here, watch this video of him breaking the world record in the 200 breaststroke, his distance per stroke, his efficiency. That is an idealized stroke for most people, not the way Adam Peaty swims. This guy is way more efficient. Everything about what he's doing is better.
Absolutely. Everything.
If he was 6 foot four and maintained his frame, he'd go like a 48 and 100 breasts and yards.
Yeah.
But he was like smaller than me. He's like 5'9". And when people talk about, oh, size doesn't matter, I'm like, are you telling me someone who's 7 feet tall is not going to go a 16 and a 50 free with Caleb Dressel's agility? No, of course they are. Like, don't be naive. Like the reason why people are 6.5 feet tall and they excel, like don't be naive here. So anyway, that's how I think about the mechanics.
Oh, that's really good. I think, you know, it's so funny again, it's funny I'm a fellow of a lot of things, but Tony Robbins is one of them. He talks about mirroring. And I'm not doing that. We grew up in unparalleled universes that ended up to be parallel. But to hear you say that, here's something I say, and I said it to Rocco Meering. I go, I never show a female swimmer to a female swimmer of mine that wants to be elite. I never show one because I don't think anybody does it right. And then Lydia came along, and Lydia's arm recovery, I don't think anybody should be upside down at the end of their breaststroke pull. So even Petey, who's really good at getting that head back down into position, still has a little bit of that stuff going on where it's not making him go forward, but it's so fast that you have to do it frame by frame. Well, I go like you, frame by frame, and like, okay, right here, he could be better. His legs could be all those things. His legs could be better. But because he puts it together as a package, and you're exactly right, for him, he doesn't want a bigger kick, you know, and maybe for Michael Andrew, he has to have that big of a kick. Mm-hmm. According to the people that are mentoring him, that'll be a discussion for off Zoom. But the people are mentoring him, his kick needs to be that big. I don't know. But I would do the same thing you're doing, is I would say, this is what I think he could do better. Should every swimmer look like every other swimmer? Hey, look, not every girl, no girl is going to have the arms of Petey. But I always tell my girls is, get as strong as you can in the upper body, because very few girls are strong. Take a look at Lily King and then get your arms in position nice and flat before you kick. And they may agree or disagree, but I think at some point you have to take a stand. And what's so funny is, in interviewing Lydia's coach, she said, and this is something that you probably don't see as much, and I certainly don't see as much, how wonderful of an example of how much impact you're having, is her coach said, I said, before, when I started the interview, I go, you know, I've been to Alaska and I did a clinic there, and I talked for, you know, 36 hours over 3 days. And, you know, I just wanted you to know, I like Alaska. My wife grew up in Alaska. And he goes, Steve, I was sitting in the front row when you did that. And I raised my hand and I said, at the end of it, do you think I can be a world-class coach? And you said, yes. Now, I didn't remember him at all. And, you know, because you do that if you're with a lot of people, and especially when you're sitting behind a camera like us now, is you don't remember. But he had learned what I taught way back then about flattening the hands and getting the head down without going upside down and up. It's not so much the up as you stopped going forward, and you don't push the water out, because that doesn't, it just cancels. And you see right. All these people doing this, including Lily. And I went, oh my gosh, I can finally show a female swimmer. And I said that to him, and he goes, you know, you taught me that. And I'm like, oh, you gotta be kidding me.
Full circle.
It's amazing. But sometimes, and do you ever, I'm just gonna ask you this, because I feel this way sometimes. Sometimes I wake up in the middle of the night and go, oh, I've got an interview next week. This is a perfect example. I did a video analysis of the Olympic trials with Dressel in the middle, and who's the Andrew on the right,
Nathan Adrian
on the left. Both Michael Andrew and Nathan Adrian pulled with the top hand outside. Of course, me with my big mouth, I said that the race is over. And I had worked, fortunately, I got to work with Greg a lot. And when he was in Hawaii, he was sending, we were showing videos, and we were showing how maybe Dressel could find just a little more doing this and that and this and that, little stuff, really, like you do, little stuff. Sometimes it's big stuff. Dressel doesn't have any big stuff that he could do better. Yeah. But, but I said, at that moment, I stopped the video and I said, this race is over right now. It's the 50, you don't pull on the outside. I've got an interview next week with Matt Kretich. I don't know if you know this, but Matt Kretich, a la Bill Boomer, teaches pulling with the top hand first.
Mm.
So that's a difficult, Matt, if you're watching, this is a difficult interview, because he might be right and I might be wrong. And do you ever have that fear that you told everybody what to do and maybe it's not the right way after all?
Yeah, but I accept it. No, okay. I know exactly what you're talking about. Okay. And I'm totally cool with it. I actually don't mind if I say something and then new information has come to me and I decide to change my mind. Okay. I have no problem with that.
Good. We have
and
to do
I
that.
Think I'm not that grounded in the way, like I haven't really made any hard changes, but the way I think about training and technique, it's evolved. And I think this is the key here. I was hoping we would talk about it, but I'm just going to bring it up. Good. This has to do with like the innovation that happens with that you or I have nothing to do with. This is innovation by someone like Caleb Dressel. So there are people out there, the people who break a world record or the people who do something for the first time, they're the innovator. So if someone does a 50 free faster than anyone's ever done it, they've done something that no one has ever done. Therefore, they are the innovator. So what did they do to make that happen? Mm-hmm. And I didn't tell them to do something. No. They did it. And no coach, really no coach can take credit for this, because at the end of the day, it's the person who's executing it. And so sometimes the coach has a big say in directing them towards a certain way. And that can be done through training, through technique, whatever. But at the end of the day, the athlete is the one who's going to execute it. And sometimes the athlete is the one who actually innovates the way that they're training, the way that they're swimming. They come up with some way to do their pull, their start, their whatever. They're doing something and that was completely on them. Like no coach should ever take credit for that because the athlete did everything. So the athlete does the innovation and then we, like you and I, we're analyzing what was this innovation and how can we share with the world what this, and sometimes the athlete doesn't even know the innovation that they did. And I think one of these, as an example, I haven't looked at this that much, but people were talking about Dressel's start specifically. Okay, he gets off the block like an animal. He enters the water further than everyone. He's entering with more speed. Like we get it. That's kind of obvious. But when he enters the water, he isn't kicking immediately. And I think some people notice that when you look at like his Olympic race, he enters the water. He doesn't even dolphin kick. He's saving, you know, the 0.2 seconds. He's just floating. And then he starts dolphin kicking. Did he come up with that? Is that faster? Did his coach tell him to do that? Regardless of how he ended up doing that, that right there, if it's faster, that's an innovation. And so we as coaches and society in general, we'll look at that and we'll be like, well, why did he do that? How are we going to learn from that? Should we be doing that? And then we have, and the more we have that innovation, that's how people get faster. It's kind of like with, I think the underwater dolphin kick is probably the most prime example of that. No one used to do that. Mm-hmm. People started doing it and then everyone realized, oh, that's faster. And now everyone does dolphin kick. We still are at the early stages of underwater dolphin kick, in my opinion. Still, no one pushes 15 meters in any of the races. Like, it's actually kind of hilarious when you think about it. You have a method of swimming that's proven to be faster, and yet people don't even do it at the highest level. So clearly, there's an innovation because like, oh, well, you can't do it because it takes away from other parts of the race, because if you push 15 meters, then you're going to die at other parts. No, that just means you're training wrong because you can't handle doing that for a minute. Like, we're literally only talking about 1 minute or 2 minutes of output. And you're telling me that a world-class athlete that trains 40 hours per week can't do something for 2 minutes? Like, think about how silly that sounds. So clearly, clearly there's more innovation that can happen, because when you watch a race, if you just objectively look at like a 200, oh, so people are going to go 4 seconds faster than this if they just do what's possible. Like, yes, like literally every world record in the 200 has the potential to be like 2 to 4 seconds faster, just if people execute the way that we know that people are capable, but no one's doing that in races, in training. But the people who are going to do this are the innovators. And so kind of tying this back to your initial question, like the way I'm telling people to swim and train, sure, once the innovator makes something happen, I'll learn from that. And then I'll try and teach people how to do it. But do I know all of that innovation? No. Does Caleb Dressel know all the innovation? No. But I think people can contribute. And then we, as you know, as a culture, we can learn from that and we can democratize all that information. And that's how people continue to get faster.
Well, I think the big thing that that we're trying to innovate is to give, is, I mean, it's out there. It's already out there. It's like he showed that underwater dolphin kick and there it was. And, you know, Berkoff did it first. And, you know, as far as we know, as far as that far. And we said, we all could have learned from Berkoff. It wasn't quite that simple. And what's funny is they didn't keep it that secret. It was pretty, by the time you tried to do it yourself, you were dying, because there's no way you could just go underwater and all of a sudden you take 3 strokes in the first lap, the backstroke. So we had to learn that. Second thing was, as a biomechanist, I looked at it and said, you know, that's great if you have, I got in touch with Marty Hull, who did a lot of studies at Stanford, came up with the zoomers and everything. And he did a thing called a rack where he stretched people's ankles. But he told me that all the swimmers that came in while he was there, was well over a decade at Stanford, everyone had at least, I'm going to call it 180 degrees, but real biomechanists would call it 90, because they have these other protractors, but I just use a regular school protractor. Put them on the ground, put their knee on the back and have them point their toe. Then I track it. I track how much they're stretching. But he said, you've got to stretch for at least 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes, because you're standing there at 90 degrees all your life. You stand with it, and all of a sudden you're supposed to get in the water and deflect water backwards. When you look at Dressel, point his toes on the ground, they just flop right down to the ground. When you look at Phelps, they just flop right down to the ground. Nellie Collin flapped right down. All these people have these dolphin-like ankles. You can either not teach it because the bones hit, or they have to really work at it in order to get them to be relaxed. And he actually said a lot of people are 50 swimmers when they could be 200, but they have to kick so hard to push the water backwards to stretch every single time that they're dead after the first 50. So they think they're just 50 sprinters. This stuff intrigued me. And so what I've done to go to the next level is we make things that stretch the ankles. You know, I mean, I designed them to stretch the ankles, and you could sit there for an hour, whatever you need to sit there for, and crank it down a little bit and measure. But the biggest thing is measuring. How many coaches, how many swimmers video themselves? I mean, I think I still sell the only personal, just a tripod, a reverse tripod you put on the side of the deck so you can film yourself. You bring it up, any cheap waterproof camera or your phone, and you look at yourself and you put it back down and you go, that's not what Ferry said to do, you know, but you got to have the feedback. And I just think we have so far to go in swimming. Now, I'll say this one last thing, and then you can, because I know you're right. I know everything you said about we have so much farther to go in Dolphin, but I think it's with everything. And especially when it comes to the personalization of your improvement. Some people, yeah. We have a guy on our swim team right now. We got two guys that go 20 points side by side. Another guy goes 19.4, whatever. And so we're starting to get pretty good. We're just Division I. It's our first year next year to be actually official Division I. We're not going to be, we're going to be Stanford, but we're going to be pretty good. So we got two guys. And one guy was trying to beat the other guy. He's been 9.225 dolphin kick, and you know, on a dive. It was a pretty good dolphin kick. He's trying to beat him underwater. I pulled him up the other day and I said, you got to take two less dolphins probably and start swimming when this guy's still underwater. Now, here's what happened with Bowman. I tell this story all the time, and I don't think Bowman ever told it. And I don't think he even told. I don't even think it's true. I don't know, but I'm just gonna make it up. I think his deal with Phelps was this, because you're talking about the training and training into it. I think he said, look, I'll let you breathe every stroke and fly, every single stroke. He's probably talking to his 12-year-old when he got him, right? But here's the deal. You got to kick out to 15 meters and, you know, or as close as you get to 15 meters. I'm sure they had an exact point. And you're going to take this many strokes. Remember when his goggles fell off in the 200 and he said, all I had was my stroke count? How many swimmers can say that, right? So then he said, I think that's the deal. And here's what I tell my swimmers is, if you're dolphin kicking down there, you're not pulling. So how many pull-ups can you do? How many push-ups can you do? How many rotators, which I think are more important than pull-ups and push-ups, how many shoulder rotators at full blast can you do? And then tricep pushes in a row at full blast, how many you got in you? Because I think for a 200 fly, you're going to fade. But if you didn't have to pull as many times, you could be kicking. And if you've done a circuit in the weight room, when you thought you were dead on one exercise, went over to the next exercise and you set your personal best, right? So I think that's the deal he made with Phelps. And I think that's the deal we need to make with our swimmers is we're going to give you these things to do that are personal, and it's going to optimize what you can do. And then you have to go out and do it yourself. But the biggest problem, and Ron Aiken and I just know it, it's feedback. We're not even asking. If you go to Ron Aiken's workout right now in Las Vegas, which would be a cool thing for you and I to do. I think it'd be fun to stand on the deck and just bug him. But if you ask his swimmer, anytime, and they might be going 8100s on the 102 averaging 55. These are the girls that are doing that. He told me that set. And they work up to it. Right now they're doing 30, and the next cycle they do 60. Yeah, I've seen his whole workout plan, and it's insane, Ferris. I mean, it makes us look like beginners, I think, but I think we can incorporate it. But they always know. You can ask anyone, how many strokes did you take on the last lap? Boom, just like that. I know, because we got one of their recruits and I tested it last week. Third level down on their team in Sandpipers. And I asked her, how many strokes do you take in the free? How many strokes do you take in the free and fly? And she just like that. But again, no feedback. So I think, and one last thing to prove it. Can you imagine in running, somebody running the 1500 meters and being on the 4x100 relay? No way. And yet we have Ledecky and Michael and other people coming down to the 4x2 and unbelievably the 4x1 and still having world record in the 400 meter IM or the mile. We have a long way to go in our sport. And PD might be the best example of there'll be a time when we specialize so well that those things won't happen anymore. But I think in a way, Ledecky's not trying to do, but I think in a way she's sort of rubbing our nose in it. Don't you think? We have a long way to go.
Yeah, I agree. I think when you see someone being able to be so dominant in multiple events, it's saying that they're really good, but it's also saying that the playing field hasn't leveled up to the potential. So it, like, you know, when we're talking about like innovation in terms of doing something no one else has ever done, the best example, I mean, maybe you can think of them. There's a few up there, but one of them is just Caleb Dressel going 17.6. So as a percentile difference from what anyone else has ever done, I think that's the most in any swimming race. It's like 4% or something. It's something ridiculous. It's the equivalent of like Usain Bolt running like a 9.2 or 9.3 or something.
Yeah, exactly. Like,
and if you were to tell someone in running, they'd be like, that's not possible. And that's, and it's, you know, Dressel's amazing, right? So 17.6, but that just means the rest of the field hasn't really stepped up. Like, it is possible. I think to use the Dressel again, Tom Shields was like a 44 in the 100 fly, and he's my age. So I grew up like in high school, like he was the top, you know, high school guy. And then he goes to Cal. I think he won the 100 fly all 4 years. And I think from his freshman year when he went, I think it was 44, maybe it was 45 or whatever. It was clear that he had the most consistent underwaters in the NCAA. Like, no one would argue that he didn't have, like, maybe he wasn't the fastest of 15 meters, but he could do it again in the second 25. Yeah. And he ended up swimming on like the 50 free, like the 4x50 freestyle relay. And he could go in 18 only because he could dolphin kick to 15 meters on both 25s. But his freestyle itself actually wasn't that fast.
Yeah.
It was fast, but not 18 fast. So anyway, so you see someone like him and it's like, dang, this is the fastest person in the NCAA ever. Like, no one's, and Caleb Dressel goes to 42. So it's like, is this saying a lot about Caleb Dressel or just the fact that we haven't really gone up to where we're close to? I think it's both. Caleb Dressel is the innovator, but also the rest of the field is just slow relative to what the potential is. And I think this is where it kind of controversial. People don't like it when I say this because you don't want to like put down someone who's not a big swimmer. But like, I believe in the next 50 years, most of the Olympic final, most of the NCAAs, whatever, it's going to be people close to 7 feet tall because they're the ones who are theoretically going to be the fastest. Like, it doesn't matter. Like, if Caleb Dressel was 7 feet tall, he would go under 17, no problem. Like, there's no physics argument saying that, like, momentum equals mass times velocity. If he weighed 300 pounds instead of 180 or whatever he weighs, he would enter the water with more momentum. Like, this is a physics thing. It's like very obvious. So right now we don't see it. Right now we see some guys who are like 6'4", 6'6", 6'8". You're like a giant in the world right now. Same thing as basketball. You can have guys that are 6'2", 6'4". They're incredible players. They will always be a 7 foot tall player will always be superior to a 6'2" athlete. You know, Michael Jordan, he was 6'6", I think. Now you look at LeBron, you look at all the best players, right? They're all on the higher end of, you know, a 6'2" player can't compete with LeBron. It's not going to work. I think in swimming, we're just behind. That's going to happen in swimming. We're not there yet. And it might not happen in my generation. We might need to wait until 2100 or 80 years from now. We might have to wait 80 years from now. And then if you look at like, what is the world record? It's 19 long course. And the guys who are doing this are 7 feet tall. They're entering the water with more momentum. And you can't say like, oh, they're big and bulky. They're going to sink. No, they have the same physical abilities as a 6 foot tall guy. But you kind of weeded out the 6 foot tall people are no longer competitive because there's a 7 foot tall version of them doing the exact same thing. We haven't seen that yet because the top athletes are not swimming. The top athletes are selectively doing basketball. And I think eventually the cream of the crop is going to be the best physiological specimen in every single category. You even see this in weightlifting. It's really interesting. I was watching TikTok. You see all these 18-year-olds that are like deadlifting like 600 pounds and they're like doing it natural. And it's like, how are these people? Like when I was in high school, man, no one looked like this. How are these? It's because all the information is available to them and they start training at age 10, they start developing, and then the internet exposes the best. The average 18-year-old still can't lift 600 pounds, but the internet exposes the absolute cream of the crop. And we're starting to see that with swimming. Caleb Dressel goes 17, everyone sees it within 24 hours.
Right.
So that way the 10-year-old version that is 7 feet tall, eventually they're going to be 7 feet tall, they could be the one that's going to go 16. So
I think you're exactly right. Paris, we unfortunately started late, and I can't wait to continue that discussion. And by the way, I'm not going to agree 100% with you. And that's a good thing. But because I mean, I look at Dressel at 6.3, but I'll just put that out there. But if you would be willing, I would love to have you back and we can go through maybe stroke by stroke of what we think is going to be what is the present and what might be the future. I think that would be awesome. Is that we'd be willing to do that?
Yeah, sure. We can make it happen.
All right. So I'll get in touch with you. I got an athlete at the door right now. Okay. I'm out of time. It's just been awesome, man. And you are the man. I tell you, there aren't very many people like you. And I think it's right. You're right. You found your passion at a young age and it's just so obvious. And I think, I think you've made me better. So I thank you for that. And I'm sure a lot, all those million people that are watching you, I think that, let's make it 10 million, huh?
Let's go, baby. Well, I appreciate it. Thanks for taking the time and look forward to reconnecting soon.
Awesome. Thanks again.
Cool. Adios. Bye.